Hi, everybody. This is Johnny Van Zandt with our new dog, Quinn. You're watching Audioprism with Vanessa Hundley on American Hearts Radio Web TV.
And salutations, everybody. It is April 11th here in Atlanta, Georgia, 2016, and happy April Fool's Day to everybody, you know, 10 days later, but who cares? It's a foolish kind of month. Tonight, I was supposed to be joined by the legendary comedian Jerry Farber, but unfortunately, he's been taken down by the Augusta version of pollen, and if you're a resident of Georgia, you know, guys, we rarely get snow. But when we do, it can be rather epic, mostly because of the ice. But every spring, we are guaranteed to get a huge influx of what we call yellow snow. And in this case, it's pollen. It coats everything. And it takes everybody down a little bit. It's got me a couple times with the coughing and stuff. But unfortunately, he was down in Augusta for the Masters performing, which is wonderful for them. But they kind of broke him down there with all that flowery stuff. So anyway, we won't be joined with him tonight, but we do have several minutes of excellent live comedy. And of course, we have live comedy with Miss Jessica. It's all good Williams. And we will be talking with Al Burroughs, who you know, of course, because of his work, you know, with American Hearts Radio as our production engineer. He does the sound and video for all of our shows, or a great big chunk of them. But he is also a project manager. And if you need to know what that is, everybody needs to know what that is, really. So stick around. First, we're going to go off the charts with some music in honor of April Fools. This first set with Off the Charts is some really, really funny songs that they just guaranteed to give you a giggle, and by groups that are well noted for their comedy. The first one is actually a solo artist. You should know him by now. If you haven't, you've been living under a rock for 30 plus years, and that would be Weird Al Yankovic. This is actually off his 2014 album that he came out. This was his 14th studio album, so he has done many a clever cover, or a clever parody, per se, of really, really famous songs. This first one is called First World Problems. It borrows elements from Pixies tunes like Debaser and Hangwire, and it's kind of a surf punk commentary on how entitled we've become as a world. So we're going to enjoy a little bit of that. So there you go, guys, Weird Al. And of course, that was my snazzy little off-the-charts intro because I just sort of blew right past that. But, you know, it deserves to be seen. So seen it was right there at the end of that. So again, First World Problems by Weird Al. There's a link in the description below this video, of course, as there always is for anything you see on this show or anything that I talk about. But go, love it, Weird Al. He's the master. My second song is by a group called Axis of Awesome. I was introduced to them a couple of years ago. They're a super funny comedy song team that my daughter's a huge fan of, and she turned me on to them. And the first song I heard from them was a song called Skeleton Man, but that is not the song we're going to look at today. This song is called Beauty and the Beastie Boys. By the way, the Axis of Awesome, they're an Australian musical comedy act. Their members are Jordan Raskopoulos, Lee Naimo, I don't know. It's a little weird. And Benny Davis. Oh, I can pronounce that one. The trio cover, they cover a wide variety of performance styles, so you hear all kinds of things, but they also do these really cool things where they'll take several songs and kind of link them all together. And they did this from Beauty and the Beast, but it's called Beauty and the Beastie Boys. So enjoy this, guys, and make sure you check out Axis of Awesome.
Tale as old as time, song as old as rhyme, Beauty and the
our guest, put our service to the test. Tie your napkin round your neck, Cherie, and we'll provide the rest.
Soup du jour, hot hors d'oeuvre, so why we only live to serve?
I tried the grey stuff,
it's delicious.
Don't believe me, ask the dishes. Cause nobody can do it like Gaston can do it, come on.
No one's slick as Gaston, no one's quick as Gaston, no one's next as incredibly thick as Gaston.
For there's no man in town half as manly.
Perfect, a pure paragon.
You can ask any Tom, Dick, or Stanley, and they'll tell you whose team
they prefer to be on.
Before the upload. But yes, listen with caution. But that's the Axis of Awesome. And again, you can find a link to that song, and then they have so many more. You will laugh and laugh and laugh for a while. So let's do some musical resurrection. These aren't funny songs, but they have the word fool in them, and they're both classic epic songs by classic epic artists. The first one is Chain of Fools by Aretha Franklin. It was actually originally written for Otis Redding by songwriter Don Covey, but after producer Jerry Wexler listened to it, he chose Aretha to do it. This song in 2004 was rated number 249 on the Rolling Stones list of the 500 greatest songs of all time.
Chain, chain, chain,
chain, chain, chain.
I can't imagine anyone other than Aretha singing it, but who knows? We might be having the same conversation about Otis Redding had that decision gone the other way. The next song is Led Zeppelin's Fool in the Rain. Now, it's a pretty long song, but it's an amazing tale of a man who's supposed to meet a woman on a street corner, and he spends the whole song wondering where she is, only to realize by the end of the song that he actually was standing on the wrong street corner. This was the third track on their 1979 album, In Through the Outdoor. It was the final U.S. single they had before they disbanded in February 1980. Bassist John Paul Jones and vocalist Robert Plant got inspired to use the samba beat, that's the breakdown, kind of towards the middle of the song, after watching the 1978 FIFA World Cup tournament. The song was never performed live because it was very heavily studio dependent until the year 2005 when they actually played it on stage with Pearl Jam for Hurricane Katrina benefits. So we'll check out Fool in the Rain by Led Zeppelin. Again, guys, Led Zeppelin, Fool in the Rain, is worth bearing a listen to. And if you just keep listening, you'll get to that samba breakdown. I want to take a quick minute to extend my condolences to the Van Sant family. Jimmy Van Sant, who played with Lynyrd Skynyrd, actually lost his battle with cancer. And there's some beautiful tributes to him on American Hearts Radio. So, you know, please stop by, check him out. He was a legend in his own right. And he will be missed dearly by all that knew and loved him. My first guest, Jerry Farber, like I said, unfortunately could not make it. He is, like I said, at home fighting off the Augusta pollen monster and the ensuing throat issues that come with such things. And you probably know at least five people talking like that right now if you live in this area. All right, so we have a video montage of his show from summitcomedy.com, and we're going to take a few minutes to just laugh and giggle, enjoy the stand-up. This man has been in comedy for over 50 years, and it shows.
Don't get mad at me. I got a 58 Chevy with 35 more payments on me. Yeah, man. Good to laugh together, folks, because I'm going to tell you, I'm really becoming old. And I was in Vietnam. I was a youngster in Vietnam. And not Vietnam, Canada. I was up in Canada. I was way up there with Henry Davis. Up there in Alaska, actually. And I was up there with Dan Quayle and Newt Gingrich and that crowd up there. And Bill Clinton won the Yellow Heart 2 years in a row. And the reason is I'm a member of two distinct minorities. I'm half Jewish and half Catholic, and that wasn't popular. Wasn't popular in the Jesse Helms part of North Carolina, which is all of North Carolina, basically. You know, I'd go to confession, being half Catholic, half Jewish. I'd say, bless me, Father, I've sinned, but these are my lawyers. I'd like you to meet my lawyers. Bernstein, Lipstein, Lipschitz, Kalkitz, Horschitz. Let me... for just a moment, brag. I only lost one match the first 3 years to a kid from Auburn. And she was good. This girl, I'm not kidding, this girl, she had to be 6'5", 270. She was a cheerleader. She was a double wide. They called her double wide. I love his wife, Gail. I've got a one. I've had three wives since I was here, and they weren't mine. None of them. They were my friend's wife. Rather have my friend. You might get beat up, but you won't lose your house. I'm not losing another. I lost two houses in my day. I'm not losing another house. That's it. I've been here for a short time, and I'm serious. You all can't see them, but there's a wonderful-looking 23-year-old man right here, a youngster, and a little bit tentative. I just want to tell you that one day, as cute as you are, you're going to look just like that man right in the next time. Life will take you in the back alley and kick the you-know-what out. That's going to happen to all of us. And as cute as that young lady is with the red hair, you're going to look like Hillary Clinton one day. That's what's going to happen. That is what happens to be here, because when you see a beautiful woman right here in her 30s with a man in his 60s right here, you know he's got money. Right here. I'm sitting, and he's my best friend, but... Johnny, this is not lust or passion. That's about $20 million of Coca-Cola stock right over there. I was lying on the sofa last night. My wife said, you want to go?
So, yes, guys, that is the montage from summitcomedy.com. You can find that on YouTube if you want to see the rest of it. And Jerry Farber will be on next month. He has assured me. So we will be dragging him in here one way, shape, or form. No matter what, next month he will be here. But I promised you live comedy, so let's have It's an All Good Minute with Jessica, It's All Good Roles.
I can't wait to see which form we bring Jerry Farber in here. I mean, there's so many options, right? Yeah. No? All right. So, I am Jessica Sawgood-Williams, and I'm here to bring you that It's All Good moment. Now, you know, I like to bring positivity. I like to add advice. And, of course, with it being April Fool's Month, well, we might as well talk about relationships. That's right. I feel I'm qualified to give advice. So, What can we do to make our relationships more all good? Well, let's say you're having an argument. You don't like what your significant other is saying. How do you fix it? Kiss them dead in the mouth, like in mid-sentence. Like they could be like, I told you, every time you throw your socks, and boom, shuts everything down, just like that. Might even change the direction of the conversation. You feel me? Yeah, all right. Now some of you are thinking, well, you know, Jessica, I just don't know how to appreciate my significant other. I try, it doesn't work out. Let me tell you the best way to appreciate a relationship. Don't have one. Yeah? Think about all the single people out there whining about their lives and how they ain't got nobody. If you go single for a very long time, when you find yourself in a relationship, again, it's going to be real good, at least for the first 6 months. And if you're thinking, well, how do I get ready for this? How do I prepare myself? Imaginary friends. Now, don't get me wrong. Back when you was a kid, you know you had one. So why not have an imaginary girlfriend or boyfriend? Go out on a date with yourself. Get two seats, two plates, two drinks. And let's be honest, some of you still got your imaginary friends floating around somewhere anyway. My name is Jessica Sawgood Williams, and it's been all good. And I always say, if it's good with you, it's good with me. If it ain't good with you, well, nobody was asking you in the first place. Have a good night.
Guys, so there you go. It's your All Good Minute with Jessica It's All Good Williams. She's going to have a little special announcement for us towards the end of the show, so stick around for that, because she's going to be talking about a place she will be performing at very, very soon. All right, so guys, my next guest is, of course, Al Burroughs. And Al Burroughs is, of course, our production guy here for audio and video, and many of the people in the Atlanta area doing American Hearts Radio. But he is not only that, he is a man of many musical pedigrees, including performing with the legendary SOS Band. If you don't know who that is, type in SOS Band. It's the only one. And you will discover that you know much more about their music than you probably think you do. He's recently gotten his certification in project management, however, and that is what he's here to talk about today, and what a project manager does and how a project manager can help you with your event or any other scenarios where you might need somebody to manage a project.
Okay, so, done.
Thanks for coming out from behind the camera.
Yes, well, you know, I mean, you know, I had to get in on this project. So.
Yeah, exactly.
He's a project fiend, you know?
Yes. All right, so first and foremost, we say project manager.
Yeah.
What does a project manager do?
Well, the thing about, first of all, let's talk about a project.
Okay, a project.
Have you ever moved?
This is why he manages projects, because I would not think about it this linearly. I'm like, what do you do?
Have you ever moved?
Yes, quite a few
that
times.
That was a project.
That was a project.
It was unique. It had a beginning and an end, and that was a project. Some people hire people to move them, okay? So that would be considered project management. Basically, we project manage all the time. Anything that we do where it has a distinct beginning and a distinct end, go on vacation. That's a project. Yeah.
It definitely has a definitive beginning and an end.
Definite beginning and an end, yes. And again, it's iterative, meaning it can change as you're working on it. So let's just say that you said you're going on vacation and you make plans and they change. Well, that's part of a project too, you know, that things can change. So,
yes.
What you do is you just take that scenario and you will take it to the next level. Say you're going to build a fighter jet.
Mm-hmm.
That's considered a project.
Yes.
It's got to be designed.
That's a very
it's
got to
be.
Yeah.
Okay. I know somebody told me, a friend of mine told me that the Bank of America building downtown, mm-hmm. they may have had 90 project managers on that. again, the construction of it had a beginning and an end.
Right. True.
You know, so project managers or projects are everywhere.
Right.
It's just that you need to hire some people who have specific skills in the area of project management to make sure that the project gets done correctly and, you know, all the things are taken care of. We have what we call the triple constraints, which is scope. In other words, what needs to be done? That's the scope.
Okay.
You got cost.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Every project has cost for the most part. And then you also have, let's see, scope, cost, and time.
He was paying attention in class.
Yeah, the triple constraints. And then the thing is, all of that is covered up by risk.
Yeah, yes.
You've got cost risk, you've got time, schedule
Most
risk.
Most projects have some kind of risk involved.
Exactly. You got risk with the scope, in other words, what the project is going to be. You've got to make sure that there's, you know, you've got to deal with the risk. So it's a whole bunch of little stuff that goes on them when you're, quote unquote, a project management professional or someone who does project management for a living. That's what you deal with. You
know? So you're the guy that comes in on the beginning and
yes.
says, here's the idea. And then by the end of it, they have the idea.
Right.
You say, that's your idea. Now we're going to find out what kind of pieces you need, how long it's going to take to make all those
million
pieces
questions.
Yes,
I need to know that. I need to know that project in and out. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to sit down and I'm going to fill out all kind of forms. I'm going to take all kind of notes and I'm going to ask you a thousand questions. So that I can assess what needs to go on. Now, the thing is that if you've got a project that requires you to have four or five different people on it, okay, they generally say you want to bring in a major stakeholder in the project will be someone who is going to be positively or negatively impacted by the project.
Right.
Okay.
Somebody that has some dice in it.
Exactly. Exactly. Now, you have some people who may not have as much, and you have to figure out who those people are. You know, and you put some over here, you got some over here, and you have to, as a project manager, you have to manage all of that. And then you have some people, they may just be, may manage risk. You have some project managers, and it's just their job just to manage risk. You have some project managers, just their job to manage costs.
Right.
You know, so depending on the size of the project and all that type of stuff, and then it really changes the dynamic, you know. Some companies, you have companies that just hire project managers, and then they have what they call a project management office, okay, or project management organization. And what they do is that they basically will oversee anything, and they just pass down things that they want you to do as a project manager.
So this is something that would be very useful, you know, event-wise, if you had like concert with multiple bands, if you had...
The Super Bowl was a project.
Yeah, the Super Bowl is a project.
Yes,
yeah,
yes.
So if you had like a really large wedding and you needed, you know, it's kind of like a wedding planner,
but much bigger,
this like the scope of everything.
Exactly, exactly. And so, yeah, you would pull everything. So in terms of on the front end, you would ask questions, but if it wound up being where, so me as a project manager, I don't have to know how to make a cake.
Right.
I don't have to know how to do lights. I don't have to know how to sew dresses. I don't have to know how to, you know, all the various things. That's not what I need to know.
Right.
We bring people in who know those things.
Exactly.
Okay. And then what we do is we take in all the information and then we build up a game plan and then we go forward.
Yeah. Excellent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what got you interested in moving into that after all the years of doing?
Well, I was always doing it. I mean, the SOS was my evening job.
Ah.
Okay. I mean, I'm not even, but weekend job.
Yes.
Okay. But now I'm into something else. I mean, I'm doing project management, but the new kid on the block is data analytics.
And that's data for...
In other words, when you pick up your phone is putting out data right now. Well, Bell South is collecting data. Or AT&T, I'm sorry, they're collecting data.
Yeah,
when you're on the internet, it's data. When you move from point A to point B and your phone is... So data is just a huge part of our lives right now.
It is enormous. And trying to keep up with social media.
When you go into a store, if you have a website and you have analytics on that, you want to know where people are going on your website.
Mm-hmm.
If you go into a store, they've got ways of tracing you throughout the store. And so they pretty much pull all that data together. And they try to find out ways that they can do better business or increase their business by understanding the data. And that's the new kid on the block. It's about maybe...
So you can manage the project and keep up with the data afterwards.
That's my whole exactly.
Exactly. I was going to say, you've got this one thing that you can do. And most of us in the entertainment industry really are extremely multifaceted, partly for survivor skills.
Now, I'm gonna let all the creative people know, if you are a creative, okay, data analytics is huge
it is
when it comes to creative people.
Yes.
Because what happens with the data is it comes in and on the database, then they have to clean it up, meaning mm-hmm. get rid of all the trash that came in, and then they've got, you know, the clean data, and then you have to find people who are able to go in there and creatively find information right. that nobody has access to. And a lot of the data scientists is what they're calling them, are creatives. They're mm-hmm. people who are creative. So I would tell anybody out there who's creative, who's looking for a side gig, they got a band, yes. and they want a side gig.
Yeah.
Monday through Friday.
Exactly.
A well-paying side gig.
Get some data analytics.
Check out some data analytics. I mean, and the thing is that what's crazy is that you would think that would be the last thing. I mean, when you talk about musicians and artists and stuff like that, you know, we're too creative.
Not in this day and age.
But right now, man.
In this day and age, it's almost less about your skill and more about how many people you've gotten to like you, which is really kind of a sad thing, because there's some incredibly talented people out there who are just floating under the radar, and some really...
I mean, you could
loud,
can,
not talented people who are at the forefront of things.
I mean, I'll give you a great example. What's so interesting about it? I recently got a subscription to IBM Watson.
Yes,
it's free. You just go on and you just, because they want people to play with this stuff. They're trying to come up with stuff that works. So
what is that?
I'm sorry, Watson is that big computer that played. What was the name of that show where you guess you say the. They ask you a question and you give the answer, but they give you the answer first, and then you come up with the question. Jeopardy.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Watson won Jeopardy, and I mean blah 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 blah. Ah. So it's this computer. It's just basically this supercomputer that they're creating. IBM is creating. They're putting all their money into it and all that other kind of stuff. But they give you access to the analytics side of using Watson. You can anybody can do it, and it's real cool.
Nice.
You know, and but the thing is that you. You can get on there and you can just, it's amazing what you can find out about stuff. And I'm telling you, people who are creatives, I'm telling you, this is for you. Try it. That's the beautiful part of it. Just get on there and start finding stuff. Okay, let's see. I want to know. Okay, so we're going to take men from 20 to 30, live in Atlanta, blah, 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 blah. So we start finding all this. Women, if you want to get on there and find some real stats about the men, this might work for you.
What's the best way for people to contact you about either of these?
Yeah, you can call me at 404-234-4301, or you can reach me via email, iegatlanta@gmail.com, or you can hit me up on Facebook. I love Facebook. Facebook is my social side. It's where I just do all
and
my goofing
a,
off.
And there's a link to your LinkedIn profile below here, too. Because that was very all-encompassing. And that was a great way to sit there and be like, this is Al. So if you go below here in the description, you'll find a link to Al as your project manager or data analytics guru. Yeah.
Oh, well, I'm telling you, it's going to be a blast. And the thing is, the funny part, then I'll let you go. It's at the very, very, very tip.
Mm-hmm.
Per the CEO of AT&T, it's at the very tip of the whole thing. He said that this will change our lives the way the internet changed our lives. So if you think about the impact that the internet has had on our lives, they're saying analytics is going to have just that much of an impact. Yeah. So look out. Here it comes.
For better or worse, guys. Here we go.
Strap yourself in.
So it's going to be like a dark analytics now.
Right?
All right, guys, we're going to treat you guys to one more funny song. Without this guy, this comedian, I probably either may not have ended up in this chair or it would have taken me a lot longer to get here, because it was just by comedian Josh Harris hiring some of my equipment, actually, for a video shoot that I even met Dan Glazier with Comics on Parole and then got introduced to this.
I didn't know that.
I know.
I have to run some analytics on that.
Yes.
See what the odds are.
So he has a brand new album coming out this month, and I'm super excited. He just did a live taping for it at the Earl Strand Smith Theater, and Earl Smith Strand? It's in Marietta.
The Strand.
Strand. We just call it The Strand. Yeah. I was trying to be formal. Yeah, right? I just tripped myself up on that one. But anyway, he did this song a couple years ago, but I believe it's going to be on this album. And it was the only one I could get a full-length version of my hands on. So, guys, enjoy Baller on the Budget by Josh Harris. This is off his album, I'm Here, You're Welcome.
Yo, it's your boy Josh Harris. I'm about to show you how to live large without getting charged. It's called balling on a budget, baby. You don't need a whole lot of cheddar to make life better. Just these few simple tricks. You've heard a rap of 50 Cent? Well, I ain't got his kind of money, so call me Buffalo Nickel.
I got the money in my mind, but in my wallet not a dime. But that ain't keeping you and me from a life of luxury, girl, I want you to know. See, I got all the crazy schemes for living way above my means. Soon you'll see I got it made up, ballin' on a budget. K, ready, set, here we go. I'll pick you up in a Porsche, but how should I say it? The owner of the car, well, he thinks I valeted it. But while he's eating dinner, for the places we could go, we'll hit all the hot spots, cause I'm the man. Get you into the best clubs like Costco's and Sam's.
And all of the haters, they sit and they sulk. They're jealous cause we get to buy stuff in bulk.
Yeah, yeah, I'm ballin' on a budget, now you know. Yeah, yeah, I'm ballin' on a budget, now you know.
There you go, guys. That was, yeah, sorry. Sorry, just totally cut her off in her groove. But yes, guys, Josh Harris, I'm here. You're welcome. New comedy album coming out very, very soon. And you know Josh, right?
Yeah, we all know Josh here.
All right, guys. So, Miss Jessica, quick announcement about your show at...
Yes, it will be at Cosmopolitan Live, formerly known as Cosmopolitan Restaurant off of Delk Road in Marietta. It is going to be a one-hour comedy special with yours truly.
Yay!
We're going to have a good time. The show starts at 8 o'clock. Tickets are only $10, mm-hmm. and the doors open at 7:30.
Get there early, have some drinks, have some food, check out the new Cosmopolitan Live.
Oh, yeah.
Best upgrade to Cosmopolitan.
It's really nice. I think they've got a band that night, like on the other side of the venue. So after the show, if you want to stay and dance, I'm always down
to dance.
They'll
be doing live music every Friday night, and they have DJ Frank Ski and somebody else there on Saturday.
It's hot. What they've done, the place is amazing.
I
like went in and flipped out. I was almost cried in public.
All right, guys, visit my website, www.audioprisment.com, for more about all the upcoming stuff that I have going on, because you know me, I'm always getting into some stuff. You can find me at G's Midtown Sundays and Thursdays, doing karaoke Sundays from 6 to 11, Thursdays from 9 to 1. Guys, have a wonderful, wonderful month. Until I see you all again, please check back often, subscribe, like, tell people.
All that stuff. Tell everybody.
Exactly.
Look at everything.
Sayonara, people.